Today we're going to try something a little different. Rather than completing a project in one sitting, we're going to spread it out over two videos. The project is a fabric canvas book. Here's the cover, and this is one of the inner pages. I'm going to show you how to make the cover and pages, how to prep them, and how to age them with paint. I'm also going to show you some techniques that I use for adding color to fabric and paper to create coordinated elements. Next week we'll talk about some additional techniques, and we'll also discuss layering to create visually pleasing pages. I'm going to show you how to stitch the book together to finish the project also next week. I hope you enjoy creating your version of this fabric canvas book. This is 100% cotton canvas. It's unprimed and it comes on a roll that's 53 inches wide, and a half a yard will be more than enough to do a book with a cover and 2 to 3 signatures inside. When it comes off of the canvas, when it comes off of the roll, obviously, there's nothing on it. So what you have to do is cut it to whatever size you need to make your pages and your cover. In my case, the cover was cut 10 by 12 and the pages are 9 by 11. And when I say cut, that's actually a misnomer because I trim and then I rip. Now, like all fabric, this has a selvage built in to both ends, and in order to get this fraying that you see here, you actually have to tear this. And so it's as easy as snipping and pulling. And these strings will be all over the place, making you slightly crazy while you're doing this. But just figure out where your measurements are, snip, and then pull to tear. Once you do that, you'll end up with a piece, and this is one of the inner pages. You'll end up with a piece that looks like this. Now, as I said, these strings are kind of all over the place, but the nice thing is the next step is to gesso this, and when you gesso it, it's going to hold all of these edges in place so that it's not going to continue to ravel once the gesso dries. Once your canvas is cut and you have however many pieces you need in the sizes that you need them in, the next step is to add gesso to both sides. Now, when I do this, I work on some freezer paper. I lay this down with the shiny side up. It ends up being a disposable work surface. That means I don't have to spend a lot of time cleaning up. I can get messy and it's not the end of the world. When you gesso these, you're going to do them one side at a time, and I generally lay out a fairly good sized piece of freezer paper so I can lay all these pieces out and just gesso one side all at once. And when you do this, the point is not to load these pages with gesso. What you want to do is spread a reasonably thin layer out in such a way that there are parts of the natural color of the canvas showing through. I don't want globs and I don't want lumps. I just want some fairly even coverage. And as I said, you can see that I'm not deliberately covering every last section of this canvas. It's going to make a difference when it comes time to age these pages later on with paper. Once I'm through, I run my brush across just to smooth out any lines and to make certain that I don't have any glops or things that are going to run. When that's finished, and again, you'll be working on both sides, you're going to end up with a piece that looks like this. What you've got is gesso, and in this case, it is on both sides, but areas of the canvas that are showing through, and as I promised, these are stiff. These edges are stiff now, where the canvas was torn, and this will not ravel any further than this. Before I forget, in the last segment I should have warned you, when you lay out all of your pieces of canvas and you're gessoing them, gesso one side, let that side dry, and then flip them over and gesso the second time. If you don't and you turn them over while that first coat of gesso is still wet, what's going to happen is that the freezer paper is going to make the gesso shiny. I know this from experience, so don't do that unless you want shiny. The next thing that we're going to do, now that we have a piece of canvas that's already dry, it has gesso on both sides, is we're going to age it with paint. I'm going to start with a disposable palette. I have Golden's Titan Buff paint here. This is a fluid acrylic, and I have micaceous iron oxide here. I'm going to slide this out of the way, and I'm going to move this where you can see it. And what I'm going to do, the first step, is to start. You need to dampen this piece of canvas, and I'm using a natural sponge to do that. This needs to be wet all the way through on both sides, although obviously you don't want it dripping, but you definitely do want it to be wet on both sides. So I'm going to come back and I'm going to wet this again on this side. This being wet is going to allow the paint to flow a little bit more easier. Wet without being soppy. The next step is to squeeze most of the water, as much as you can, out of your sponge, and you're going to come in and you're going to use your sponge and you're going to dip it in the Titan Buff. And once I dip it into the main puddle of fabric, excuse me, the main puddle of paint, I'm going to come back and I'm going to spread it using the palette pad to move it around so that I have a larger area that's actually covered with paint. And I am going to move this out now so that you don't see it. Once that's done, I'm going to come in here and I'm going to dab, which is one process, or the other thing that you can do is just kind of swirl it on here and rub it on with this sponge. Again, because this canvas has been pre-wet, it's going to allow us to come back and move this afterward and get some nice blending without this being harsh lines. Right. And once I do this, I'm going to take, this is just an inexpensive rag that I use, and I'm going to come back and I'm going to use it to blend in any place where I think that Titan Buff has gotten a little bit too dark. Not only am I going to blend, but I'm also going to rub out some of it. And if I think for some reason that I don't have excuse me, quite enough color, I'll come back and I'm going to sort of paint up or ink up that sponge again, and I'm going to come back and just dab it again in a few places. And then I'll move back in with this rag and just blend and buff out anything that I don't like. What I'm trying to accomplish here is to make this look aged without making it look like I deliberately aged it. I guess I'm trying to be a little bit subtle to make it look like this book is a little time-worn. It's been around for a while. Once I'm satisfied with the way the Titan Buff looks, the next step is to use the micaceous iron oxide. This is what I use to simulate dirt that might have accumulated or rubbed onto the fabric over the years. Now, you can see that the sponge still has Titan Buff in it, and I'm going to come in and I'm going to pick up some of the micaceous iron oxide, but I'm going to do that fairly cautiously because this is a very dark color. I don't want a sponge full of it or I'm going to end up with something that I'm not happy with. So I'm just going to come in and I'm going to dab very lightly, and then I'm going to come back to the palette and dab to spread that color around a little bit. And then the next step is to come in and to start dabbing this color. And it's just a question, again, of finding a look that you like, whether it's a lot of what looks like aged dirt or a little bit less. And if you want to do a little bit more to have that color be a little bit stronger, you can certainly do that in spots. And then it's just a question of picking and choosing and thinking where this would look good with some age, some dirt, some history, if you will. Do that until you're satisfied with the way it looks, and then put it to one side and let it dry. If you really hate something, you can come back in here, and one of the more interesting things that I discovered is if you wet your tip of your finger on that rag and you come in and you rub, not only will you rub the micaceous iron oxide away, but you're going to rub the Titan Buff away down to that white gesso, which creates just an entirely different look. If your tastes run to colors a little less neutral, you certainly can use something other than the Titan Buff and the micaceous iron oxide. On these pages, I did the exact same thing as what I showed you earlier, where I gessoed both sides, and then rather than Titan Buff, I used quinacridone nickel azo gold as my base color and came in with cobalt turquoise and added the highlight colors. Again, aged with a different color group, but nonetheless still more than flat and a lot less boring.